A story came out on NPR today. This is January 21st, 2021. And it said nearly one in five defendants in the U.S. Capitol insurrection cases served in the military. So one in five in that large crowd were actually military people. I guess that's what patriotism is, y'all. That's what it is. I'm going to go ahead and play this audio from NPR.
We're still learning new information about the people involved in the attack on the Capitol on January 6th. One trend that has alarmed military leaders is the number of veterans who appear to have taken part in the insurrection. By NPR's count, nearly 20% of people charged in connection with the attack and rioting are veterans. NPR investigative correspondent Tom Dreisbach is here to talk about what we found. Hi, Tom.
Hey, Ari.
So begin by giving us an overview of your findings.
Well, we took a look at everyone we could find who's facing criminal charges in connection with the attack on the Capitol on January 6th. The charges run everything from curfew violations to unlawful entry of the Capitol grounds, theft of government property, weapons charges, assault, among others. And anecdotally, we had heard reports about a number of military veterans among the people who were involved in some way. We knew, for example, about Ashley Babbitt, who was killed by police while climbing over a barricaded door inside the Capitol building. She was an Air Force veteran. You might have also seen photos of a guy inside the Capitol wearing a military-style helmet, tactical vest, and carrying flex cuffs. Well, federal prosecutors said his name is Larry Brock, and he's an Air Force veteran. And so what we wanted to know is exactly how big is this group?
And as we said, the number is close to 20%, almost one in five people. Put that into context for us. How does that compare, for example, to the overall percentage of veterans in the U.S.?
Yeah, about 7% of all adults in the U.S. are military veterans, according to the Census Bureau. So that proportion of vets among people facing charges is quite a bit higher. But there are close to 20 million veterans in the country overall. It's a large, very diverse group of people, especially the younger generation, and the vast majority, we should say, do not get involved in extremism. But of course, this is still a problem.
Is there any way of quantifying how big a problem this is in the armed forces and among veterans?
Yeah, I mean, our colleague Tom Bowman reported that last year the FBI had notified the Defense Department of 68 investigations of current or former service members in connection with possible domestic extremism. There's also a survey by the Military Times last year that found about a third of active duty troops said they had personally witnessed white nationalist activity in the military, things like drawing swastikas or getting white supremacist tattoos. Now, I talked to Mark Petkavage of the Anti-Defamation League about this, and he said, you know, so far the military's efforts to combat extremism in its ranks have largely been haphazard.
So an extremist discovered in one unit on one base over here, there may be prompt action taken. The person may be very quickly administratively processed out. A very similar extremist in another unit on another base somewhere else, maybe nothing is done.
Well, Petkavage says there really needs to be systemic training throughout all of the services so everyone knows how to identify a problem and what to do once they spot it. And the Biden team has said that rooting out extremism is now a top priority for their administration.
Tom, this problem has newly become apparent, but is it a new problem?
No. I mean, we've known that some extremist groups like the Oath Keepers, for example, they have specifically targeted veterans for recruitment over the years. And the concern is that military veterans often do have specialized training, which can make attacks more deadly. You know, some experts point to Timothy McVeigh, who killed 168 people in the Oklahoma City bombing years ago. He was an Army veteran. And so the stakes can be high, but, you know, we should say among vets, you'll also find really strong resistance to extremism, too. The police officer, Brian Sicknick, who was killed that day at the Capitol defending it from the mob, he was also a veteran, and he served in the Air National Guard.
NPR investigative correspondent Tom Dreisbach, thanks a lot.
Thanks, Ari.
You know, this is why they said you can't really trust anybody, you know, but we know every industry is infiltrated when it comes down to extremism, white supremacy. These folks are in every single industry, especially the military. And we know they're in policing. But to be honest with you, I'm really not surprised that these sort of people were in the crowd. Aren't these your biggest whiners and complainers and always talking about somebody taking over their country and all that stuff. It's usually these military type people saying these sort of things. So, I mean, just looking at this and just a reminder, these are the same folks that smeared pee and poop all up and down inside of the Capitol. These are the same ones that tried to overthrow the electoral vote that day, you know, where they were certifying Biden's win, and they went in there to disrupt it. But, you know, now damn near all of them are on no-fly list, the ones they were able to catch. And many of them have to return just in a few weeks back to Washington, D.C. to face their charges. Now, we know most are going to be misdemeanor because, you know, they don't like doing anything to their own folks. They like the hard charges left to us. Just imagine that. But please tell me what you think. I mean, 1 in 5 of the people in that crowd were military. And they were not all veterans. There were quite a few in there that were active duty. Please leave your comment and subscribe. Don't forget to hit on the notification bell, and I'll see you on the next video. Peace, family.